you're going to be disappointed here. What I'm actually going to talk today is Mission Impossible in orbital retinoblastoma. And before I go into my slides, I would like to get a brief idea of how many of you actually encounter orbital retinoblastoma in your practice. All right, okay, so quite a few of us. So I'll share my experience with management of orbital retinoblastoma. So we all know the goals of therapy in retinoblastoma are saving lives, saving eyes, and saving vision in those tumors where it is possible to do so. But it's really a story of one disease and two different worlds. So there is a, it's a challenge today to be treating orbital retinoblastoma. And it is basically defined as local extension of tumor which is confined to the orbit. And the diagnosis is made with the help of clinical examination, imaging studies, and histopathological examination in some cases. So when it comes to orbital retinoblastoma, the country that I come from, unfortunately, has the highest number of retinoblastoma cases in the world. And I work at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, which is located in New Delhi. So we wanted to see what is the incidence of orbital retinoblastoma in our practice, and we published a study in the British Journal of Ophthalmology where we found that the presence of extraocular disease was prevalent in more than 1/4 of our cases. Almost 28% of children presented with orbital retinoblastoma due to delay in presentation, lack of awareness, and other issues related with the developing countries. So, as Dr. Arun has already mentioned, it has very high incidence in Asia, and the concern is that it's a major contributor to mortality, and therefore something really needs to be done about it before we can really say that yes, we are, we have arrived as far as treatment of retinoblastoma is concerned. So, in our study, we found that extraocular retinoblastoma puts a risk of 5.2 times to metastasis as compared to intraocular retinoblastoma. And the presentation of orbital retinoblastoma mostly it is seen in older age, and kids present with proptosis, pale redness, stephylomas, as you can see in this eye. Most of them have leucochorea, and if the globe is not disorganized, but some of them present really late with a fungating mass and lymph node enlargement. So there are varied presentations of orbital retinoblastoma, and as far as staging is concerned, I'll just quickly go through the slides. So this is the children's cancer group classification of retinoblastoma, and here class 1, 2, and 3 were synonymous with a presence of orbital disease. This is the more recent international retinoblastoma staging system which we follow at our institute, and also many other places in the world are following this staging of retinoblastoma. And according to this, stage 2, stage 3, and stage 4, these are the stages of orbital disease. Stage 2 is the presence of microscopic residual tumor in an enucleated eye. Stage 3 is regional extension that could be either overt orbital disease or associated with local lymph node extension. And stage 4 is metastatic disease that includes hematogenous metastasis or CNS extension. Now, subtypes of orbital retinoblastoma could be primary, where you have a tumor, an intraocular tumor that is spread locally into the orbit. It could be secondary, where you've done an enucleation and there's a local recurrence. It could be overt, as you can see in this particular case, where somehow the imaging missed the extraocular extension of the tumor and it was seen on the operating table. It could be accidental, where after intraocular surgery, there is some form of intraocular surgery, like it could be an intravitreal procedure, or it could be a trabeculectomy or a vitrectomy, where there was accidental spread of tumor cells outside the eye, and then it could be microscopic. If you've done an enucleation, you think it was a group B tumor, but there was microscopic extension on histopathological evaluation. So this is a series where we examined some eyes who had undergone trabeculectomy in unsuspected retinoblastoma, and then we treated them as orbital disease and we managed them, and we achieved good outcomes. Now the diagnosis of orbital retinoblastoma is mainly on history, ophthalmic examination, a general physical examination. We also need a systemic evaluation, and we have a pediatric oncologist in our team to do the flag for us. The ultrasound of the orbit and neuroimaging in the form of contrast MRI of the orbits and brain. And some of these cases where the diagnosis is unclear on clinical and imaging studies may require an incisional biopsy as well. CT scan, this is a case of a bilateral retinoblastoma with orbital disease on one side, but this is a picture which was from one of the patients who had a CT scan before he came to us. We usually avoid CT scans in such patients with bilateral retinoblastoma because of the risk of radiation exposure, and therefore MRI of the orbits is what is the standard of care as far as neuroimaging is concerned. The other investigations for orbital retinoblastoma include hemogram, liver and kidney function tests, and ultrasound of the abdomen, a chest x-ray, ECG if you're planning to give intravenous chemotherapy, and or CSF examination, bone marrow aspiration or biopsy to rule out metastatic disease. Now, how has the management of orbital retinoblastoma changed? So in early times, it was mostly orbital excentration, but now we have switched to a multimodal therapy protocol that has helped us in saving a lot of lives. And what does this entail? So basically, when the child is diagnosed with orbital invasion, we treat them with 3 to 6 cycles of neoadjuvant chemotherapy. I will be coming to the protocol in the next slide. And then once we get an adequate response and the globe is amenable to enucleation or localized surgery is done, that is followed by an external beam radiotherapy to the orbit and up to 12 cycles of adjuvant chemotherapy. So the problem with this protocol is that when we did a literature review, we found that most of the studies we had, because the disease was rare, there were heterogeneous populations that were included with different stages of orbital retinoblastoma. They were retrospective in nature. There were small number of patients, different classification systems were used, and there was lack of consensus on the chemotherapy protocols. So we were not clear as to what would be the best approach. So our institute conducted a prospective comparative study using multimodal therapy for stage 3 retinoblastoma, which was published in Ophthalmology in 2016. And the question that we wanted to answer is which protocol would work the best for these cases. So we had included children with stage 3A retinoblastoma that was overt orbital disease. And we didn't have any kids with metastatic disease, those with history of prior treatment, or parents who were not willing to participate in the study. And so the kids who fulfilled the inclusion criteria were randomized into two groups. We had two groups, group A and group B, and this was the chemotherapy protocol. So the group A children were treated with 3 drugs, vincristine, etoposide, and carboplatin. And you may like to note here that the dose of vincristine was lower than what is used for standard therapy, whereas the dose of etoposide and carboplatin was stepped up as compared to standard therapy. This treatment was given at 3 weekly intervals, and a total of 12 cycles were administered. And for group B, we had a 5-drug treatment. We had alternating cycles of vincristine, cyclophosphamide, idarubicin with etoposide and carboplatin. Again, this was given for a total of 8 cycles. And these kids were then recruited, and the response to treatment was assessed on clinical examination as well as MRI. Enucleation was carried out at the appropriate time, and that was followed by putting a PMMA implant. We usually avoid integrated implants in this case because they're going to get radiation. So this is one such example where you see the child with orbital disease, and then the picture on the right is after chemotherapy and before the eye underwent enucleation, and similarly you can see a good response on the MRI. Now, adjuvant EBRT was administered in a dose of 40 grays in 20 fractions over a period of 4 weeks. And this was followed by further chemotherapy cycles depending on whether it was protocol A or B. This is another example of which I treated in a similar manner. So the outcome measures of this study were survival probability, cause of death, and we also looked at chemotherapy-related toxicity because we didn't find much of this information in the literature. So a total of 27 children in each group were studied, and the median follow-up was 25.4 months. Interestingly, at the end of 1 year, we found that the Kaplan-Meier survival probability, this was the overall probability, was 80%, but it dropped to 42% at 4 years. And then when we compared group A versus group B, we found that in group A, the survival probability was comparable to group B at 1 year, but at the end of 4 years, it was significantly lower in group B as compared to group A. So from this study, we concluded that the group B seemed to be more toxic, and the major cause of death, although in both groups was CNS relapse, in group B, 4 children also died of hematogenous metastasis. So it did seem that chemotherapy-related toxicity was more significant in the 5-drug protocol. And we also determined the percentage of cases that had grade 3 or grade 4 chemotoxicity using the National Cancer Institute Common Terminology Criteria for adverse events. And here you can see the bars here, the yellow bars represent toxicity in group B, and the red bars represent toxicity in group A. And we find that for each of this, the toxicity in group B is more as compared to group A, with a statistically significant difference in grade 4 neutropenia. So we concluded that the VC combination was more efficacious and less toxic, and that is what we use as a standard of care now for orbital retinoblastoma at our institute. Now rehabilitation and follow-up is equally important, care of the anophthalmic socket, doing MRI orbits and brain on follow-up, systemic examination, bone marrow, CSF. This is all a part of our follow-up protocol for these patients. So to summarize, as far as orbital retinoblastoma is concerned, what has changed and what has not? The management has changed. We have better diagnostic imaging. We have a newer staging system. We have better chemotherapy protocols, more precise external beam radiotherapy techniques. The COG-ERED-0321 trial is going on orbital retinoblastoma, and we have the results soon, and we have better survival. But what has not changed is late presentation and lack of awareness, and that's what we need to work on. So I thank you all for your attention. We are children in our clinic celebrating Independence Day and freedom from eye cancer. And I would